please welcome ECC Executive Board Member Elizabeth Sanborn.
I am pleased to welcome back to the ECC conference Amy Myers Jaffe. Amy is a leading expert on global energy policy and sustainability. She serves as research professor and managing director at the Climate Policy Lab at Tufts University and the chair of two initiatives at Columbia University, the Center on Global Energy Policy and the Women in Energy Program. She is also a member of the Global Future Council on Net Zero Transition at the World Economic Forum in Davos, and a member of the Leadership Council of the U.S. Association of Energy Economics. Amy is a frequent media commentator and is widely published, including her latest book, Energy's Digital Future. This will be the third time Amy has joined us at the ECC conference. Every conversation with her brings interesting insights and food for thought, and I am confident she will inspire us today. Like the previous presentations, there'll be time for Q&A at the end, so feel free to use the app to ask your questions. But please join me in welcoming Amy Myers Jaffe.
Good morning, everyone. I'm hoping that three times the charm, right? It's so great to be back, and great to be back with such a big crowd and in such a beautiful place. And weather's been cooperative, so all good. I'm going to talk to you today about the energy situation, and I know Peter set up a pretty dire outlook for supply chains and everything. But I don't believe that Putin's going to win, so I'm going to explain to you a little bit why, what's going on, the difference between oil and natural gas, and then talk to you a little bit about innovation in the space. And even though they get angry with me that I always intertwine them into my speeches, I just want to tell you I have three children. We know the end of the story because they're adults now. And they majored in three different things. One majored in engineering, one majored in creative arts, and one majored in finance. I'm betting on the third one for my retirement. And I want to tell you a little story about how they wound up, because they're all in fields that didn't exist at the time they were studying, right? So my daughter works in batteries and hydrogen and alternative energy now. The son in finance is in the packaging field, doing innovative packaging that works for specific agricultural products. And my son is in streaming TV. So I sort of share that. You know, when you hear these stories about we're not going to have enough employees or we're not going to have enough materials, I don't have to tell this industry that that has actually never held the industry back, right? We've innovated in materials, we've innovated in structures, we've innovated in geology. I mean, we are a country that the world is now relying on our oil and gas from places that we thought were 10 years ago, you heard a speech from people saying it was all used up, we're peaking, blah, blah, blah. And we know I'm going to explain to you that we're still far away from that. And we haven't even really brought as much robotics into the sector as we're going to. You know, we have companies that have already drilled a well, you know, using artificial intelligence and computerization and not human beings. So we know where we're going. And I can talk to you a little bit in the Q&A. I don't have a slide on that. But speaking of which, let me get my clicker. I have a whole chapter in my book on self-driving vehicles. So if you think about the problem of shipping goods today and the labor shortages and so forth, and you think about a platoon of trucks in a dedicated lane that only the first truck has a driver, and you think, well, Amy, you know, we're 30 years away from that. We're already experimenting with that in the United States. So just letting you know that. And you already have companies that have products where the drones that you see being used by the military or by commercial applications are going to take people from a rooftop to another rooftop to avoid traffic in major cities. So there are a lot of things coming that seem like something that would be in an animation movie or back in the Jetsons. And you know, those things are going to be real and becoming real very quickly. And so I tend to really try to get people to focus on innovation and positioning their companies in innovation to be ahead of that curve, so that you're not the company that's struggling because of supply chains. You're the company that's ahead of the supply chain problem because you're already down this innovation pathway, looking at digital, looking at other ways, 3D printing, to solve the same problem. So let's talk about oil prices for a minute. That's everybody's $100 question. You know, what's going to happen in oil prices? And you know, you guys have heard me in the past, and I'm not changing my tune yet. I got it. There is the energy transition, but that's a long process, as you know. And oil is still cyclical. And that goes in both directions. We're not going to stop using it next year, the year after, the year after. And the price isn't going to 200 and staying there because it's cyclical, and the same rules are going to apply this time around. Okay, Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait and that caused a certain kind of cycle, or we had the down cycle of the recession in 2009. Those things have not really changed. I mean, the escalation now seems very severe, and I'll talk about that because we're talking about a major, you know, military global power, Russia. And so that does make it much more serious, but it's still a cycle. And we're still going to be dealing with the fact that it's a cycle. So let's start with just a 12-month level set before I start talking about what's happening now. Let's just review the facts of what happened in 2020 and 2021 from a cycle perspective. Oil demand collapsed during the 2008 financial crisis by 1.5 million barrels a day. Oil demand collapsed during the COVID 2020 cycle. Well, the official statistics are 8.8 million barrels a day. I can tell you from talking to people, there was a point in the market where we were down 30 million barrels a day. And we had a containment problem everywhere in the world except the United States, which you might remember. The congressmen here and senators here in Texas had to literally go on television and threaten Saudi Arabia we would cut off all of their arms shipments if they didn't turn the cargoes around, because we were concerned that they would fill all the storage in the United States and we would have logistical problems because we would have no operational storage. Okay, so that was 2020. Now we get to 2021. There's a vaccine. People are getting used to the idea that we're gonna, you know, move around and go about our normal lives. We kind of get out of this panic about the pandemic. And we have this giant economic growth in 2021, which was fantastic. Oil demand globally went up 5.5 million barrels a day in 1 year. Now, back when it was 2020, everybody had to stop drilling. We all know that because everybody in this industry suffered from that. But globally, they stopped drilling in Nigeria. They stopped drilling in Mexico. They stopped drilling everywhere because guess what? We all had a containment problem and there was no place to put the oil. So that's like a super cycle. That was like the 10-year or 5-year cycle on steroids. It happened over 2 years. So now we're in this upcycle that started in 2021, and enter Vladimir Putin, and he suddenly realizes that he has leverage everywhere. Now, Europe did the right thing putting these sanctions on. You saw the price go up. Part of that was geopolitical, which Peter's already talked about. But part of that was just sort of the market reapportioning supply. So about 1.5 million barrels a day of Russian oil that normally was going to certain trading houses and certain refiners in Europe gets rejected. Eventually, that volume finds its way to India and China. So actually, believe it or not, where we stand at this minute right now, there is actually no global disruption in oil. We haven't lost any Russian barrels. The United States was selling oil from the Strategic Petroleum Reserve. Saudi Arabia is producing what they've been producing. Everybody in OPEC's producing what they've been producing. So there really hasn't actually been a supply emergency yet in oil. A lot of that was psychological. You know, if you look at just relative, so I have a slide here just to give you a scale. If it were to turn out that Putin says, okay, that's it, I'm cutting off all of Europe from oil. I'm just talking crude oil here, not diesel fuel. It's still smaller than what the markets have adjusted to in the past. And so I really feel like we have to like scale everything and try to think about the fact that markets respond and that we have the tools to respond. You know, I was giving a speech last week, honestly, to a group of utility executives from around the country, especially a lot of emphasis for people. It was in the Midwest, so a lot of people attending were from the Midwest. And you know, I got a lot of questions about how there was going to be this catastrophe in California because of renewables. And when I started explaining about software and demand management, the crowd actually booed me, okay? And so I asked everybody in the audience, it was a big audience like this, I said, raise your hand. Everybody's a utility executive. I said, raise your hand if you have looked at what the heat wave projections are for your state or your region for the next 10 years, and have you done any planning for standby power and backup power connected to those projections? I said, raise your hand if you've done that. And no one in the room raised their hand. And then I said, well, guess what? No one's done that in the state of California either. And we have this heat wave that has raised electricity demand in California by about 30% over a week's time. And it's not, I'm not saying that renewables won't be a problem at some point in some locations, but the bottom line is that's not what's going on in California today. What's going on in California today is we're having this sudden surge of demand, and the utility has to figure out these mechanisms to cope with it. So we now know the end of the story, and this is an unpopular thing to say standing in San Antonio, Texas. But yesterday was the last day, or today's the last day of the heat wave, and using demand management techniques, they did not have rolling blackouts. And I say that standing in Texas. And maybe there's someone in here that talks to Texas PUC or other kinds of ERCOT regulators, because it did actually work. And I'm not saying that California couldn't have a problem down the road. I mean, the governors had to cancel the retirement of Diablo Canyon nuclear plant. I'm just saying that, same to my theme, that when you have these digital management techniques, right, where you have more data and more ability to have precise information, there are things you can do to manage these horrible situations like California's having this week with the heat wave, where you don't have a catastrophe. And that's really my theme for you today. So I'm not saying that the Russians might not cut off all oil shipments to Europe in the next couple of weeks, because that could happen. I mean, Putin said it, and unfortunately, he's a guy who says, when he says things, oftentimes they happen. But, and it'll be hard, but we know from these past disruptions in the world market that we found other ways to get around it, and that actually, you know, especially in the West, especially in Europe and the United States, we're pretty resilient. So I'm concerned a bit about the global South, you know, Africa. And places like that. But I do think that the more we are able to cope with these and manage these disruptions, the better it is for the rest of the global economy. So, you know, what's the big problem now? It's a problem we've had in the past, and I can chart it out and show it to you, which is that OPEC doesn't have anything left under the ground they can throw back out into the market. Right, so we have rising, eventually we're going to keep having rising production in the United States and Canada. You have Exxon gearing up Guyana, and you know, you have some extra oil coming out of Mexico and Brazil and a few other places. The UK just announced last night, you can watch me on CNN, that they're going to increase their operations in the North Sea. even some talk about doing fracking in the UK. But the bottom line is, right now, we have a very thin margin of spare capacity in oil, and so the market doesn't have much flexibility, and that's why you're seeing this, you know, very inflationary feel in the oil price. And you have the counter trend, which is the Chinese keep locking down cities for COVID, and you have the supply chain problems that are kind of slowing the economy, and one could expect the economy in Europe is going to slow as the governments have to spend more money on energy aid and spend less money on other things. But the bottom line is, that is the current problem today. I still think we're going to see a lot of volatility in oil, even though we're kind of weathering through right now. It's really a pretty geopolitical question, and that makes it very uncertain. Now, natural gas is a totally different story, and why do I say that? Because the disruptions already happened. So here are the numbers. Pre-COVID, Europe bought about 200 BCM a year from Russia. In June, that was down to 50-60 BCM. Now it's even lower, and I have some expectations that it's going to go to zero. We'll see. Putin announced today he's changing, he's going to pipe all this gas to Europe to China instead. But actually, the numbers are actually pretty small. Right now, he's shipping 15 of the of the 200 BCM he's losing to China. In 2025, he can get up that up to 38 BCM. And to get to like above 50 or to, you know, closer to 100, which I don't even think he can do, they're talked about this pipeline. That pipeline won't be on for 10 years. Gazprom will be bankrupt way before that pipeline comes online. And the current pipeline, which you can see that's channeling the 15 BCM, everybody says it doesn't earn any money, it's a cost center. Okay, so Russia cannot switch where it sends the Siberian gas, period. It goes to Europe, and Europe is going to stop using it. And it might stop using it this year in a catastrophe because Russia's making that decision, but in the 3 to 5 year time frame, the Europeans are not going to buy your Russian gas. They are making plans to buy American gas or other kinds of imported LNG, right? Germany's added several floating LNG terminals. So I don't know if any of you are in floating LNG, but, you know, great time to be in floating LNG technology because, you know, to the extent that people can bring on the gas, the floating LNG technology is going to give countries flexibility. You got the Europeans, I think, have already put in or committed to 5 different floating terminals, receiving terminals. And we added a lot of export capacity this year, and we have Golden Pass coming on, you know, by 2024, which is going to be a big boost. So I think our industry is sort of moving apace. But, you know, we're limited by how fast we can bring facilities on, and we already kind of, like, know that story. I'll talk to you a little bit about the 10-year view and what the industry's thinking. So when one looks at the so-called supply hole in LNG, it's pretty interesting because there's a lot of opportunity. But then when we talk about the energy transition, you have to think about, you know, how are you positioning yourself? Are you going to just invest in LNG? Are you going to invest in alternatives to LNG? So the amount under construction for the U.S., by the majors, and that's in every location, is only 28.3 million tons a year, right? And, you know, proposed it's closer to 30. But we're going to lose 40 million tons a year because this LNG is not coming from Russia. You know, Arctic 2 is not going to happen. Baltic LNG is not going to happen. Partly because even if the Russians were willing to finance themselves, they're not going to be able to get the technology, honestly. Right? And they're already going to have trouble with the LNG. They're already having a little trouble with the LNG plants they already have. They still have. So LNG from Russia is not going to be, I think, commercially viable for the new projects. And so you're going to continue to have a problem, I think, in the LNG market over time. And that raises the question for the industry as a whole, which is, you know, great opportunity for the U.S. projects, but there's a limited number of them. So is the opportunity going to be servicing that, the new LNG terminals, or is the industry going to be servicing what's going to replace LNG because there's not enough LNG available and the price is going to stimulate countries to want to do something else? And that, to me, is the big uncertainty that faces the industry, and there's opportunities in that, and there's opportunities and risk. So it's very timely and popular. Like, if I wanted to get everybody here to hire me as a consultant, all I'd have to tell you is there's this giant hole in the LNG market. It's going to last, which I do think is true. And 100%, you're going to make big money in LNG. The price of LNG is going to stay at $20 internationally, blah, blah, blah. And I would tell you there's no cycle because it's LNG. The problem is that's not what's going to happen. What's actually going to happen, which is already happening, there are countries that have priced out of LNG. Pakistan can't get LNG. You know, Sri Lanka can't get LNG. You know, India having to tell utility customers they can't have gas because they can't get LNG. Right? So countries are going to respond to that by trying to think about what else they could do. And I just did a study for the United Nations Commission on Africa, because you've read in the press that, you know, Africa wants to be able to use natural gas. And then a light bulb went off, and people started to realize that they have a lot of hydro resources, and they have, you know, sun and all these other kind of resources. They have some wind, they have offshore wind, and that maybe gas is not going to be available even in Africa. And so therefore, they needed to put more emphasis on renewables, not because they're being led by progressive institutions, but because that's the most energy secure thing they can do. And they can control it. So let's talk for a minute about what happened in the United States, and I'll tell you about some other countries. So we didn't pass the Green New Deal. I mean, let's not do fake news in this room. There was no Green New Deal. Obama never passed it. It got tied up in the courts, and it never happened. So what happened with coal retirements? You know, the coal plants in this country were built 50 years ago. This is how many retirements happened with no regulatory policy forcing retirements. You know, you had the mercury rule, so I guess that might have pushed a few people over the edge. But these were plants that were going to close based on financials and based on the natural gas industry. Okay? Where are the additions? You can see that the additions were based on availability. You know, you had the Appalachian and Marcellus gas, and you have the pipelines from Texas, and you put in a lot of natural gas on the eastern part of the country. And in the Midwest, we put in a tremendous amount of wind. And in California and the Southwest, we put in a lot of solar and batteries. And the reason I mention that to you is not to try to convince you, you know, oh, it's all, you know, renewable energy transition, blah, blah, blah. This is what actually happened. And this happened on a commercial basis because we have no carbon price in the United States. There's no federal carbon price. There's an active market in California, that's it. I mean, there's a little market in New England, but it's not really incenting much. Okay? This is what happened with basically no regulation. And this happened not under the Biden administration. This happened under the last administration. So this is a trend that is a commercial trend based on the lowering and falling costs of technology, based on what's available, and I didn't bring it because it involves other companies' data, but if I were to superimpose the top midstream companies that operate between Oklahoma and you know, the Great Lakes, you would see that their natural gas pipelines could pick up any green hydrogen that could be made from any of these wind farms. So there is going to be a huge opportunity now that the federal government is giving out tax incentives to convert or to apply with existing infrastructure a build-out of alternative energy. I have to tell you, some of the biggest trading companies in the world are building CO2 pipelines in the United States and are talking to people about carbon sequestration projects. Again, tapping federal incentives. We're talking about the companies that you see in Europe moving cargoes about and making, you know, billions of dollars today off of the volatility in markets. They're taking that money, some of that money, and investing in CO2. So, and they're in commodities. That's all they do is commodities, but they're investing in the hard assets to be a player in CO2. So I think that's relevant to this group. Again, they're not progressives, right? This is about the commercial opportunity. So let's talk India. People in India are being cut off from LNG because it's too expensive. The Indian government now has responded to that by just announcing a new, more ambitious target for renewable energy in India. And Reliance Energy, so some of you might work with or have heard of, they have pledged $10 billion of their budget future spending in the next 5 years, 10 years to come in renewables. They have pledged to build out an entire green hydrogen network in one of the states, major states in India. And you have ONGC, the state oil company, is investing in offshore wind. So when people tell you, oh, there's going to be this big market for natural gas in India, the Indians are not projecting their natural gas market to grow. They're projecting their renewable markets to grow. And they're targeting that from the government. Let's take China. Some disagreement among the different Chinese major, you know, universities. I would tell you that the government most listens to or is highly respected, and we who work with them highly respect Tsinghua University, has, you know, some of the top energy experts in China. And you can see from this projection that they have for 2030 and 2050 that they're seeing China reaching its net zero pledge for 2060 with renewables and batteries, carbon sequestration, and nuclear. And they're not, I mean, there is going to be this boost in natural gas in China over the next couple of years, and good news for the United States is a lot of the, I think a third of all the contracting that's come from the third wave of LNG has gone to Chinese entities. So bad news for Russia, good news for the United States. But the bottom line is, again, they are not planning a build-out based on natural gas. They are planning to invest in the technology to back up renewables with batteries and hydrogen and other kinds of systems. So let's talk about batteries in the United States, because as you know, batteries are coming in Texas. I mean, Tesla is in Texas now. So this is a Woodmac historical chart of the deployment of batteries in the electricity industry. So not in cars. This is just for backup of electricity. And this is kind of what I say to people. Number one, you can see the growth, and the supply chain in China problems with COVID shutdown didn't really affect that growth that much. I mean, it affected it, but there was still growth. And then the second thing, which I think is much more important, is that if you look at the locations where those batteries are going in, they're going in places where electricity is getting disrupted, which makes sense to give system operators flexibility. And you can say, well, listen, Mrs. Jaffe, like, I get what you're saying about batteries, but it's 4 hours. In a major electricity crisis, 4 hours means nothing. I mean, what means 4 hours to someone? And it might mean 4 hours during 5 p.m. to 8 p.m., which is when everybody needs to have electricity. So it could be a really important 4 hours, but I get it's just 4 hours. But do I have that on the next slide? I think I don't. Oh, I do. But we're starting to build out other things that are going to be out of service storage. There's something called an iron air battery. I'm not an engineer, so I'm going to garble this, but basically the natural rusting chemistry that happens with the battery is somehow tapped to generate, participate in the generation of electricity. They're very heavy. You know, think Edison from the old days had those lead batteries. So these are very heavy batteries, not going to put them in a car. But if you had a power station, you could stack it next door to it, and you can get a couple weeks of battery storage. Or some people say it could be longer, well managed with you know, demand and time management. And some people say that could replace coal plants and might make it unnecessary or could become very commercial in a competitive way with peaking power natural gas. So that's why I say, you know, I can give you a good forecast about LNG, but you know, there's these companies and they have these technologies, and if they hit in the next couple of years and you're gonna have the tax incentives, then it could make a big difference. So during the 2009 stimulus, there was targeted loan guarantees for utility scale solar in the United States. And the result of that now is that it's proven out, and we have a lot of utility scale solar in the United States now. This same thing could happen with batteries. Let's not forget the federal government originally gave a loan to Tesla. Right? So and it's the same thing with hydrogen, right? Because hydrogen is a storage technology, so if I don't have use for my wind resources in the Midwest, I had a, when I was talking to my electricity utilities last week, I had a gentleman come up to me from Oklahoma, and he told me his wind was critical. And then we had a going back and forth about if he made hydrogen from that wind, that he wouldn't have the wind to really prevent Oklahoma from having outages. But actually, sometimes when the wind's blowing at night, there's really no way to use it because you don't have enough demand. And so therefore, you could be making green hydrogen in the evening when you have less demand, and then the hydrogen would be available to go into a fuel cell to provide you with electricity later on. And so again, it's an emerging technology. And I mention it to this group because all the components that are going to go into that industry are EEC businesses. They're all complementary skills, complementary businesses. We're talking pipelines, we're talking management systems, we're talking equipment. So, you know, we can all focus on LNG, and you know, that'd be good for Europe for a period of time, but the Europeans are going elsewhere, and India and China are going elsewhere. So if you're having a very forward-looking business, you want to be thinking about this electricity storage problem. And you can think about it, could be renewable natural gas, right? So big thing that's happening in India and other places is these projects to do waste to energy, right? California, you know, how do I take landfill or how do I take bio waste, convert that to some kind of, you know, gas, and then use that gas with some kind of sequestration. I'm going to tell you about an invention in a minute that like makes that really somewhat realistic. Okay, and then you know, you're going to have this support from the federal government. And instead of just rejecting it because it wasn't favored if somebody in here, you know, wasn't favored by your congressperson, like that doesn't matter because there's a business opportunity here. There are companies in the United States that made a lot of money, including Warren Buffett, taking federal dollars in 2009 and doing utility scale solar, right? So that could be people in this room in these various areas, manufacturing, equipment, hydrogen, renewable natural gas, carbon sequestration with renewable natural gas. These are all businesses that work for this industry. And I'm not saying you should, you know, switch over 100%, but it's the opportunities you need to be looking at, and you need to be thinking about, instead of focusing on, I'm going to have high prices forever, which you all know because we've all known each other for such a long period of time. I mean, 25 years in Houston, how many times have I been made a speech telling you that's cyclical? Worst comes the worst, which would be horrible. We have a terrible deep recession, and the price of oil and gas go to zero again because we're in a recession if Peter's right about all his doom and gloom, right? So you can't count on that. You know it's never happened. So the question is, what's out there to help your business position itself for this future that is going to come? which I already showed you, partially coming in the United States, even without the regulation and assistance, definitely coming in India and China because of regulation, where there's, you know, strong effort, and definitely coming in Europe because they don't have Russian gas. So that's really what we want to be thinking about together in terms of what fits with my strategy to do a pilot project or get started or to get the knowledge by doing a pilot project like Dominion in Utah, right? So let's talk about, just to give you a couple examples of what's out there, because I just think it's really interesting what some people are doing that you never hear about. I mean, I hear about it because I read about it all the time and people tweet at me so I know what their technology is. And, you know, some of them are not pie in the sky. Believe it or not, there is a company today, this is the picture of it, that has a device that you can put on an 18-wheeler. And if you put renewable natural gas in that 18-wheeler, or even diesel fuel, this thing can take the carbon emissions and store them and then put it to a, you know, a carbon sequestration project when the truck gets on the other end. I mean, that's pretty amazing. It's not that big, it's a contraption. And if you think historically about the Clean Air Act and how we have, you know, tailpipe emission technology that helps with air pollution for particulate pollution, and we all don't think a second thought about it because it just works and it's out there, this company has CO2 tailpipe technology already that's going to work from the truck. You're not even going to need a battery truck. So if you were Elon Musk, because I know the girl who worked on it, and she was in charge of that department, if you were Elon Musk and you just spent the last 8 years or 5 years developing an electric truck, guess what? These guys, Remora, might make your technology unnecessary. But the technology is all the kinds of parts and components that this group works on. And the technology of what to do with the carbon after it's stored in those trucks are things that this group works in. Opportunity there. Second one, I love this one. Apparently it's proven out. I was introduced to a group of people from the airline industry, right? Former executives from the airline industry and some science people, and they have created hydrogen storage capsules, lightweight hydrogen storage capsules. There's the picture. They're so lightweight that apparently you can put them in an airplane and stick them on a fuel cell and operate a plane from a fuel cell. You know, I'm not sure any of us are going up in the sky with that system anytime soon. Maybe they're having a pilot project, but you know, that's, to me, not the interesting thing. To me, the interesting thing is, you're all in the pipeline industry, or some, many of you are in the pipeline industry. These guys have a capsule that can go on a ship and a truck that's gonna compete with pipeline. And the economics of that, you know, TBD. That's an interesting market disruption if it's a successful technology, especially given the fact that we have permitting problems with pipelines, or we have methane leakage problems or hydrogen leakage problems with pipelines. So just mentioning that, because that's an interesting technology. And then of course Dominion has this giant project in Utah that could really position them extremely well as we have a build out in these alternative fuels and innovation. So I mention these kind of companies to you because of course I'm a university professor. And every one of my students, you know, they want to work for one of these companies, right? And you're bidding against them to try to get talented young people to work for you, right? And, you know, people feel like if they go and they're the fourth guy in Remora and the technology hits, they'll be a multimillionaire. You know, I have a son in finance. He, you know, that's his head, right? And I will tell you, he began his first job was in the shale industry. Okay, but now he's in a startup. Okay, because this is the thinking. So that means we have to think about how do we organize our businesses to really attract top talent, because you have these really amazing opportunities. And I'm going to tell you a story. When I was talking to your board here from the EEC, and they were saying, well, you know, we need you to talk a few minutes about workforce. And I said, okay, I'm going to talk about workforce, and I'm going to tell this true story. I'm sure, I hope my class, they don't mind this when they see this on the video. Anyway, point is, I have this class I teach every semester on international energy policy. And, you know, today's students, they're not really willing to have the professor give you something to read, stand up and tell you what you should think, and then give you a test on it. You know, those days of professoring like that are basically over. And it's partly because there's so much information on TikTok that, you know, I had to spend half the semester just correcting some of that, right? But, you know, people come in and they believe they have a lot of knowledge, and some of them do, and some of them just have a lot of information, but it's not really, like, solid knowledge. So I'm trying to create these exercises for the students where they have to learn for themselves, and they have to tell it back to each other. So this is what I do on natural gas in my class. I divide the class in half. It's 40 students. 20 have to explain in a Oxford-style university debate. 20 of them have to argue that natural gas is a critical fuel for the energy transition. And 20 have to argue that it's a fossil fuel and it shouldn't be used at all. And they have to prepare for 2 weeks, and then they have to spend an entire class period debating that. And then the class votes on who won the debate, and the class votes on whether natural gas is a viable transition fuel. Okay, so we, you know, do it every year. Did the debate this past, what are we now? We're coming into the fall, so did it in the spring. And they have the debate. The students on both sides were extremely convincing, but the class voted universally, you know, basically, you know, 35 or 36 out of 40 students, that natural gas is not clean enough because of methane leakage to be an energy transition fuel. That was the vote. And I get students from around the world, by the way. You know, I'm in Boston, but I get students from India. Fletcher School is a global studies program. I get students from China, from India, from the Middle East, from America, from Latin America. I get students from all around the world, and that's the vote. Okay, there's a punchline to this story. Fast forward a couple units later, we've done electricity reform, we've done these different things. Now we're on the unit on geopolitics. And it's like March, and the students want to talk about what happened with the Russians. So I'm talking to them about it. Student raises his hand from an international country. He says, Mrs. Jaffe, do you think the United States government should be doing something to incentivize more LNG to reach Europe? Should they be giving incentives to the industry to build more LNG for Europe? And I think, trick question. However I answer this question, you know, I'm going to get dinged by someone on my teaching evaluation, so I'm not answering this question. You all could answer the question because you're in the industry, but you know, I have to come into that classroom every day. So I turn it around and I say, well, you all spent 3 weeks on the natural gas debate. Tell me what you all think. What do you think? Should the United States now change course and focus on LNG because we have this geopolitical crisis? Same group, same 40 people, only, you know, a couple weeks have passed, and the student who asked the question says, yes, he thinks the United States needs to buckle down on LNG. It's an emergency, we need to do it. I ask the class to vote. The whole class votes pro-LNG. So I share that story with you, not to say you don't have to clean up the methane leakage problem, because you absolutely do, but to share that story for you so you understand that mission-driven is multifaceted. And we don't think of ourselves in this industry as a mission-driven company. You know, that was sort of a Silicon Valley construct, this mission-driven company idea. Right? But thinking about how you fashion yourself, what your statement is from your board, what you put on your website as the mission of your company, how you think about yourselves in terms of the mission and the role you play in society. This is an important thing for retaining and recruiting new employees. And how many of you do you know of people who left the industry to go to California and now they're back in your company? Right? A lot of people are coming back. And I, you know, I'll tell you a true story. I had this son who, as I said, worked in the industry, and now he's doing something else in a startup, and it's looking very promising. But I had someone call me one day and say, hey, listen, he's a financial officer now of a company. He could come back to the industry and be a financial officer in the industry, right? So, you know, it has to do with the mission and the incentive structure. And I, you know, have this McKinsey slide so we can, you know, talk about it a little bit in the Q&A, because this generation, whether you're talking about millennials or Gen Z or below, right, very technically able generation, they want to know there's room for advancement. They want to feel that the people they work for are inspiring. I know that sounds fishy, but, you know, you all have that potential. And it's like, how do you convey that inside your organizations culturally? And also, you know, we've all learned post-COVID. You know, there's an article in the Wall Street Journal, I think it was a week or two ago, about quiet quitting. I thought, what the hell does that mean? You like sneak out and don't tell people you're giving them 2 weeks' notice? I mean, like I couldn't figure out that term. But apparently what it means is you don't quit your job. You go to work and don't do your job. And I thought, oh my God, that would drive me insane. You know, one time I was up for some big job and literally the people who were competing against me for the job, they said, oh, she wouldn't be appropriate for the job. This is what they said about me. They said, because she makes people do their job. She expects people to do excellent work. And I thought, how is that a criticism of me as a manager? Like, that's crazy. Right? But apparently it was. So my point to you is, you know, thinking about how to integrate work-life balance is a challenge we're all facing now. We're facing it at the university. You're facing it in your businesses, right? And I would contend, because I have this in the university setting big time, you know, how to encourage people that there's something productive and affirming they could do by doing their job well and helping other people inside the organization, you know, is an important leadership function. And now that we understand what's happened with COVID and everybody's got isolated and businesses were disrupted, people's lives were disrupted, you know, we have this opportunity to do a reset. So I'm going to end with one last story. So as Elizabeth mentioned, I work on a program out of Columbia University called the Women in Energy Initiative. And really the design of that program is to help young women, and career, women are already in the energy careers. We have this thing called office hours, which could be anyone, right? Which is a university thing, but could be anyone. And really help mentor people, help put on programs for executives to think about how to build the workforce in a way that works for women. And how to position yourself as a woman to be successful in leadership in a company. And I was touring around the industry back before COVID, talking about the program, and I was doing some seminars. We're doing some sort of executive ed seminars for boards, for middle management, and so forth. And I stopped at a company, which I won't say which one, and we're meeting with the COO and the head of HR and the people from the women's executive committee of the firm. And they start explaining to me that, you know, this really can't fix it, because women just leave after they have a baby. Now, you're talking to a woman who has three unbelievably successful children, who I picked up from school while I had a full-time job at Rice, running a multi-million dollar research program, right? So not a good enough reason. I mean, I'm not saying, there are days when I really just wanted to stay home, so I'm not criticizing anybody making the decision staying home. It's a personal decision. I'm just saying that you can have a high-powered job and pick up your kids from school if your leaders are working with you. So I, you know, trying to investigate that a little bit with this management. And I mentioned that the hardest time of day for a woman is 7 a.m. to 8 a.m. Because you're getting the kids up at 6, 6:30. You got to make sure they're dressed. Their homework has to be in their backpack. You got to pin everything that you're supposed to give that the teacher signed to their shirt, otherwise they'll lose it, right? And you got to feed them. And then you have to get them into the car, which in my case sometimes meant the dogs coming too. Okay? So it's the most stressful time of day if you have kids for a working woman. And this company has their management meetings every morning at 7 a.m. You have to be there, and at 7 a.m. you have to be prepared. So I said to them, you know, you are absolutely guaranteeing that no woman who would choose to have children and still work for your company can be in management. You really ought to think about, could you have that same meeting at 4 p.m. the day before? And then you all go home, and then come in the morning and do what you decided at late in the afternoon the day before. And they said to me, no, you don't understand, it has to be 7 a.m. Can't be 9 a.m. Can't be 4 p.m. the day before. It has to be 7 a.m. Well, you guys know what the traffic's like in Houston and Dallas. Like, it's not, that means you cannot take your kids to school, you cannot get them ready for school, you cannot give them breakfast. But is it really actually, is it really the case that the meeting has to be at 7 a.m.? And if you're a man today, having stayed home from COVID for a couple of months, do you actually want to fight that traffic to be in at 7 a.m.? Does that even make sense? And they were like unable to change their idea about that. So that's what I say about work-life balance. If we can think about how we structure our culture and our timing and how we do our meetings and our strategies, I think you'd find that you would retain younger people and you would retain more women. And so I offer that story just as an example. It seems like a simple, petty thing, and maybe there is some reason why they have to meet at 7 a.m. operationally, but I'm a little skeptical. So anyway, I thank you for today for listening, and we look forward to having a dialogue with questions with Elizabeth.
You ready for some Q&A?
I am. I'm a little nervous after this last utility industry experience, but go ahead.
So the most popular category of questions is around nuclear energy. So kind of as broadly as your thoughts on the future of nuclear energy, and focused in also on the decision of Germany to cease the nuclear power production there. So that's a range. You know, specific to broad, you can address it how you want.
Okay, so I don't know how many of you watch or play soccer, but, you know, the decision of Germany this past year to accelerate and actually stick with the closure of nuclear plants was definitely an own goal. I mean, 100% own goal. They'd be in a totally different place if they had just decided to delay, even if they delayed it for one winter. I mean, it's sort of like kind of hard to understand. So, back on my slide on the stimulus, there is stimulus for advanced nuclear. There are some really interesting new designs coming out for small modular nuclear. I do believe in small modular nuclear in the sense that it will keep costs down because of the way it can be constructed and planned, and the ability to have more standardization. Which, as you know, in the industry has made a big difference for lowering costs. You know, it's still a challenge. The waste is still a challenge. I will tell you, you know, Bill Gates invested in this terawatt power in Wyoming, and everybody, you know, the big hullabaloo, you know, Gates, he's brilliant, he must be doing nuclear, it means it's, you know, a renaissance. The only thing I will tell you is that that plant originally was going to run on reprocessed uranium from Russia. So just thinking about the logistics, there are some promising companies, and molten salt is sort of an emerging technology that hadn't been successful in the past, but now we have new materials and new designs, and it's an interesting option because it doesn't require water for cooling, right? So we had this problem now in Europe with with having to turn off plants in France because the river levels were too low. We're going to have that kind of similar kind of thing we have to worry about here in the United States or on the East Coast. We've had problems with flooding and contamination of water. So I think that this molten salt, I mean, if I had a vote for design being a non-technical person, that seems like it has a lot of potential. There is a U.S. company, believe it or not, started by a young man in his 20s. He made a nuclear startup, and he's funded by DOE. And his plant design, he works together with someone from the U.S. retired U.S. military who worked in the submarine area. Their plant runs on chopped up waste rods from the United States, and with a advanced design, uses that spent fuel to create a reaction that can make steam. So I do think there are new designs coming down the line. United States promoted a small nuclear reactor to compete in South Africa against China and, at that time, Russia, and won the contract. So I think we'll see a little bit of a renaissance in this area, but you know, it's a new technology, and like most new technologies, it's going to take a long time before it scales up.
Good, thank you. The other broad category is energy transition and renewables. So the first is, can you address the headwinds to the energy transition given the source of some of the raw materials are in geopolitical?
Okay, so we definitely have, and we've had multiple bills out of Congress to look at it. No question. And it's not about who controls rare earths, because that's really not true. The rare earths are not located in China. There's a lot of places that have them. Those of you who are in the industry, you know, mining is not that different from oil and gas in the sense that it always looks like we don't have enough metals and minerals. And that is because people don't have the price signal to go out and do mining. And so if the price keeps going up, you're going to see new mines. And also, I just need to make this point because, you know, it's very in vogue to be in the industry and say, hey, you know, by the way, blah, 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 you can't even switch to these electric cars and all these new energy because there's not going to be enough metals, right? But remember, metals aren't a flow. So if OPEC is at 99% of spare capacity this year, they're going to have to do new drilling and new investment. It's going to take a couple years to get that oil. It's the same thing in mining. Price goes up, you know, Vitol or Glencore, whoever it's going to be, is going to do more mining. In the United States, we're giving incentives for people to do mining and processing. But once I have that material in a car, it stays in the car for 10 to 14 years. So I don't need it again. I mean, I need it to scale up, but then I can actually take it and also recycle it. So take the cobalt problem. Not only does GM now have a battery that's a cobalt-less design, as does Tesla, but that they have planning, but you have a company that was created by an ex-Tesla executive that's going to do nothing but recycle materials from old batteries and old machinery and create cobalt and other things through recycling. And you've got the big trading houses like the Vitols and Glencore are also in that business, right? So I'm not saying that we're not gonna have a headwind in the short term. I'm just saying that there's a market and it'll solve itself out. Now the bigger problem is not the actual physical metal supply. The bigger problem is that we were asleep at the wheel, and I mean, the statistics are different for lithium versus some other different kinds of things, but for lithium, it's like 70% of all lithium gets processed in China. And this is a problem not only strategically, I'm sure Peter may have gone into that a little bit, it's a problem for supply chains, which we've all learned. Because if China has a lockdown because of COVID or some other reason, then people are not going to work, and so they're not processing lithium. So we have to have diversified supply chains, and that is a bit of a headwind on the processing side. So then, you know, I mean, you're in the cyclical industry. It's like many things. People made the investments in lithium early and then lost money. So the question is, will they believe in it now? And you have government money in Europe, in India, in China, and in the United States, going into those major economies to pay someone to help them put manufacturing in place. So short term, yes, there's definitely a problem. You know, long term, we could have overcapacity, as we've often had in LNG as well. Anything that takes 5 years to gear up, 3 to 5 years to gear up, you have some supply chains in the middle, and then likely you wind up with overcapacity over time.
Okay, related, this is electric vehicles. What is your take on the push for electric vehicles by an artificial deadline when the infrastructure to handle the load is not there?
Okay, so definitely a problem, but let me say the following thing. And everybody gets angry at me when I say this because, you know, it's a big burden on the load. But the question is, when are you plugging in your car? And when is the mall putting in the stations? And when are people plugging in, right? So theoretically, you've got people who've designed systems where the car is part of the battery storage system. So you're going to have, again, your energy transition. I think it's not accurate to say that the energy transition is going to cause problems. What I would say is the energy transition is going to contribute to volatility because of uncertainty or because we don't have a centralized planner to, you know, plan all these things out. But the highest number of electric vehicles is in California. They just had a 30% increase for a week in electricity demand for air conditioning. And, you know, the governor and other people came out and told people when to charge their cars, and people complied. So some of that might be automated. Believe it or not, Amazon and Google have these thermostat products and that attached to your Alexa. That tells your household and your car, if you're charging it at home, when to charge stuff. You know, if you wanted to charge in the middle of the night to capture the cheaper prices from wind, the gadget, you just tell it to do that and it does it itself. So we're not doing that today. Everybody's not doing that today, but that's sort of the future. So it's kind of hard to say. I don't think anybody's actually really properly modeled the load, taking into account climate change. By that I mean, you know, heat index, drought, et cetera. And nobody's modeled that together with what I call digital energy, which is how much of the load can you offset by time of day demand. So I will say one thing. I know we're starting to run out of time, but Western Australia had brownouts all the time. And as you know, Australia is a major LNG exporter. And, you know, kind of like New England with the United States, because of the Jones Act there, I don't know what the issue was in Australia. It was non-commercial to build a pipeline from Eastern Australia to Western Australia for gas, and it was uncommercial to bring the LNG to Western Australia by boat. And so they just had brownouts. And Elon Musk went in there and he proposed something called virtual battery, where you put a little battery in the homes of everybody in a community and every business in a community, and you build that battery in the home to be 30% more capacity than that business or home uses. And then you have a software program and that works together with the system operator, and you aggregate the 30% in everybody's battery to be a power station during times you might have had a rolling blackout. And it's worked. And they don't need natural gas, and they don't have brownouts anymore. So New York City's looking at putting in that technology. Other places, Germany probably needs to look at that technology. They have so much rooftop solar. So again, there are these technologies that are coming, and, you know, proving them out and getting people to adopt them, there's going to be some lag and we're going to have volatility until people fill that out. But the more volatility we have, the higher the oil price, the higher the natural gas price, the higher the coal price, the faster these technologies are going to come. And that's really my belief, and that's what we've seen in the past. And that's why I could show you that slide that shows you all the new wind and solar that's been put in the United States in the last 10 years. It happened because people otherwise wouldn't have the electricity. This fellow from Oklahoma was very clear. The wind in Oklahoma is not what's causing volatility in power prices. It's what's preventing volatility in power prices.
Thank you. One last question. We're almost out of time. So we'll end with, if you were a millennial and wanted to start a business in energy, what would you start?
Oh, geez. God. That's an interesting question. So I will tell you, I have a former student from Rice University, and I'll tell you what business she went into. I think she's one of my most interesting students that have a business. She has a startup company that designs and deploys battery storage systems for 5G communications, telecommunications towers, and networks. 5G and data centers is a huge absorber of electricity. I think it's a much bigger problem than the electric cars, quite honestly, is this data center management issue, which, as you know, is a big problem in Texas. Her idea and the software she's developed, and she's working with some of the big, telecommunication providers, I just thought that was like a really brilliant business. So I guess if I was a wealthy person, I would give her the money to completely finance her business and be in, because I think that's one of the most promising things I've heard someone tell me about.
Thank you. Appreciate your presentation. It's always very interesting, and we're glad to have you back here.
Well, thanks for having me.